Hey, what's up, everybody? This is Dante Fortson here with part two of the United States of Egypt. Now, last time we covered a lot of the similarities between the U.S. and Egypt. We covered some historical statements that were made. Let me move my mic. Hopefully it's not too loud when I move it. Some historical statements that were made. And also, we gave some medicine out of the big white bottle. And today, Dr. Dante is back with some more medicine from two more big white bottles today. Now, before we get into today's study, make sure you guys hit the thumbs up button if you haven't done so already. Make sure you guys click the subscribe button. And if you have not turned on all notifications, please do so. Also, turn on your YouTube notifications so that way you don't miss any future videos. And last but certainly not least, please share this video. All right, so today's study, part two, is brought to you by Undeniable, full color evidence of black Israelites in the Bible. If you're tired of people, you know, running with the narrative that we don't know what we're talking about, we're taking it out of context, and, you know, everything else they say, then just show them the pictures, let the pictures speak for themselves. Undeniable, full color evidence of black Israelites in the Bible is available on Amazon.com and Barnes and Noble. Okay, so today, I got a lot of medicine. In fact, some of y'all are not gonna like this medicine. We got 1, 2, 3, 4 doses of medicine today. Four big old good doses of this medicine. Some of y'all are not gonna like it. I'm talking to Israelites and people that still consider themselves part of the Christian church, but not Israelites. A lot of people gonna get some medicine today. All right, so this chart right here, I put it out a while back. And it was recently featured on Berean TV about 8 days ago. I haven't went back and touched the video just yet, but we're going to look at some stuff today. And of course, instead of presenting it in context, they presented it completely out of context. And I find it interesting that one of Berean's guests, y'all going to hear him today. I'm going to actually let y'all hear a little bit of what he had to say. They clearly have no idea or didn't listen to how to use the chart. Everybody else with a brain listened to how the chart is supposed to be used, and yet this ignorant guest on Berean TV made the claim that this chart does not prove that Israel is black people. It wasn't supposed to prove that ever, but we're going to come back to that. We're going to talk about Egypt. We're going to talk about what it has in common with the U.S., and today we're going to be coming from Scripture to do so. And then on part three of this, I told you guys it might become a 2 or 3 part series, but on part three of this, what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and get back into the historical stuff. But right now, we're going to focus on the scripture. Now, you can grab this chart. The link will be in the description. This is version 3.0. Version 4.0 is coming soon. You can see the screenshots here. Now, the proper way to use this chart, since, you know, Berean misrepresented and his guests misrepresented what the chart was for, because they listen and they're quick to pass judgment on Israelites when they claim they're giving, you know, treating everybody fairly. And in reality, that's not what they do. So the chart is meant to take a subject in the Bible and show you all the Bible verses in which that subject appears. Nothing more. It doesn't teach anything. There's no doctrine attached to it. All you do is you go over, and I'll show you guys the chart in a second. As a matter of fact, let me move the chart over here. I'm gonna show you guys the chart now. So 400 year servitude. This right here just references where we see the 400 year servitude pop up in the Bible. And we're gonna go over that today because that's one of the similarities America has with ancient Egypt. All right, so now as we move into this, make sure you guys grab you a pair of Royal Judas if you have not grabbed them already. Yeah, put your email address in the pop-up box and get the discount code for the Royal Judas sent directly to your email. So the link for the Royal Judas will be in the description. All right, now, real quick, I have another one for you guys. Alexandria, Virginia. That's another city associated with Egypt that is located here in the United States. Remember, we learned the word Egyptomania last time around. These people are obsessed with Egypt, Egyptomania. So I'm not going to put a link to this in the description. You guys can just Google Alexandria, Virginia and learn all about it. And here's a map of Alexandria, Egypt, and where it is located. So we have Alexandria, Virginia and Alexandria, Egypt. Let me close that down. All right, so we're going to start here in Genesis. We're going to talk about similarities between Egypt and the United States. Now, here's something interesting. As much as they like to say, we're taking Genesis 15 verses 13 through 15 out of context. Well, we'll say 13 and 14 out of context. As much as they love to say that we're taking that out of context, America has something in common with Genesis 15, 13 through 14, which is why it's causing so many problems. The church can't explain it away. All they can say is, well, that doesn't mean that. They can't explain why that similarity exists in a situation where you have slavery, the enslavement of people who come from an area where they were speaking Hebrew, where they were called Israelites from the land of Judah. Shout out to Taz, where he shared something today that I think was on point, and I hope he does a study on it, because I'm definitely going to have him on to present it. But people taken from the land of Judah, speaking Hebrew, Maghrebian Arab, and local Patois. And we also learned that they have a copy of the Torah. And we also know that slaves believed that they were Israel and identified with Israel. We know that a lot of the early Christian, black Christian churches identified with Israel, and many of them believe themselves to be Israelites. This is what we've been uncovering so far. And it's nothing they can say about it, because they've already admitted, the opposition has already admitted, that there were indeed Israelite slaves on the slave ships. Garfield is the only one holding out on that in the current circle. There are other people that don't believe black people had any, there were no black Israelites on those ships, and that black Jews were just hitchhiking rides everywhere on the slave ships. All right, so now let's start with the 400 years. And we know the 400 years is misrepresented by the other side. Here's the lie that the other side teaches. You'll hear this lie on Berean TV. And this lie, for whatever reason, Berean refuses to correct it when the lie comes out, because I guess he doesn't want to embarrass certain people. They will say that we were all teaching that we're supposed to be out of here after 400 years, which is a lie. That is an outright blatant lie. And Jay, the producer, tells that outright blatant lie in the video I'm going to show you guys from Berean TV. Fair use in advance. Fair use. And you guys can go back and watch this whole video for yourself if you want to, but I'm going to show you some clips. But Jay, the producer, lies about the 400 years. At no point, me personally, and a lot of others, at no point did we ever say that we would be out of here after 400 years. Some people did. We did not. And I'm going to speak for myself. I did not. I've always taught there's a 400-year bondage and oppression, not just bondage, not just slavery, but 400 years of slavery and oppression, Jay the producer. So y'all tag Jay the producer and tell him to listen real close so that he doesn't lie, because, you know, he's that holier-than-thou type. He don't play sports. He don't do no competition, none of that stuff. So, Jada Producer, I just want to help you not lie anymore. 400 years, then judgment, then an exodus with great substance or wealth. 400 years, then judgment, then an exodus. And if you're trying to push the narrative that the judgment should have been over by now, then you have to explain why many Christians teach a 7-year judgment period, dispensationalists. You have to explain that away. Why do they teach a 7-year judgment, but when it comes to Israel, the judgment is supposed to happen instantly? So I just want to help Jay the producer tell the truth, shame the devil. So let's get it in. Genesis 15, 13. And he said unto Abram, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. So servitude and affliction, oppression, 400 years. And also, not 430, not 215 in Canaan, not 215 in Egypt, 400 years in a nation where they are a stranger. If you guys go back and watch this whole series, Beyond Deuteronomy 28, this is part 10. Watch the whole series and see what we talked about. And we're gonna recap on a little bit. And also, that nation whom they shall serve will I judge. This is why we say 400 years and then judgment. a lot of the times people like Jay the producer leave that judgment part out so they can push a narrative and say, oh, well, you guys were making false prophecies. No, nobody was prophesying anything. We're saying, based on looking at the scripture, this is the conclusion we come to. It's not a prophecy. No, nobody around here, well, I can't say nobody. I personally was not calling myself a prophet, telling people this is a prophecy. God told me this, none of that. That's the narrative that many people, including Jay the producer, have tried to run with. And it's an outright lie. And afterward, they shall come out with great substance. So now, the Bible is clear. They come out afterward with great substance. After what? Well, right before that, he says he will judge them. So he judges them, and then Israel comes out with great substance. So there's a clear order of events. I'll read this one more time, straight through. And he said unto Abram, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. And also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterward shall they come out with great substance. It's a plain, straightforward reading of scripture. Now, why is it important to understand this? I'm gonna jump over, and we're gonna pour out some medicine right now. We're gonna get to this good medicine right away. Now, this was brought up in the video with Jada Producer, and I'm gonna rewind it a little bit because I actually have it a little bit forward, but I'm gonna show some of what Jada Producer had to say about this. Now, the brother got on asking about this 400 year number, and so the other brother shared this and said, why don't you go ask them, Congress, how they came up with this 400 year number? Because see, they say that we're making up this 400 years, and yet we see here congress.gov 115th Congress, bill number 1242, HR 1242, 400 years of African American History Commission Act. And you'll hear the other ignorant brother on Berean's channel say, well, it doesn't say what you think it says. He didn't never say it said anything about anything. He just said, you asked them where they came up with this number. But the fact is, they have a 400 year period. And we just read about a 400 year period in the Bible. So they want us to believe this is coincidence. But let's read what the bill actually says. We'll start right here. It says the bill has not been amended since it was passed by the House May 1st, 2017. So now, 400 years of African American History Commission Act. This bill establishes the 400 years of African American History Commission to develop and carry out activities through the United States to commemorate the 400th year of the arrival of Africans in the English colonies at Point Comfort, Virginia in 1619. Now, you guys, when I play the video, you will hear Jay the producer talk about, well, it doesn't say anything about slavery. Well, either Jay the producer is ignorant to American history involving people who got here at 1619 up until now, or Jay the producer is a lying, deceiving devil. And we'll just say it like that. Because from 1619 to now, black people have not been treated equally. It has been slavery and oppression. And I've listened to the ignorant arguments that have taken place on Berean TV, where people come in and talk about what they own, their cars, their houses, and how much money they make, and talk about that as if that has anything to do with oppression, and it does not. In fact, let's read the definition of oppression so we're clear. So we're gonna read the definition of oppression, and we're gonna come right back to this HR 100, or was HR 1242. All right, so the definition of oppression: prolonged, cruel, or unjust treatment or control. The state of being subject to unjust treatment or control. Mental pressure or distress. Oppression. So now, does it say anything about how many jobs or how much money you make or how many cars you own or how big your house is or any of that other stuff? No, it does not. This is a fallacious argument that they like to make in order to distract from the subject at hand, because they think anytime black people talk about anything that happened in this country, they say that's emotionalism. We're appealing to emotion. And yet they don't believe that they're appealing to emotion when they tell people that they're going to go to hell if they don't accept Christ. Telling somebody they're going to spend an eternity in hell, somehow that's not emotionalism or preying on people's emotions, but telling them about factual history that happened, that's emotionalism. So let's go back. Let's see what HR 1242 was meant to establish. I'm going to tie all this together. Y'all know how I do with all these bottles of medicine I got today. The commission must plan programs to acknowledge the impact that slavery and laws that enforced racial discrimination had on the United States. So wait, there were laws that enforced racial discrimination. Again, what's oppression? Prolonged, cruel, and unjust treatment or control. The state of being subject to unjust treatment or control. So, are racist laws just or unjust? Jay the producer, Brother Berean. Encourage civic, patriotic, historical, educational, artistic, religious, and economic organizations to organize and participate in anniversary activities. I'm guessing they're talking about Juneteenth, the holiday that some of these black Christians love to celebrate. Basically, they're celebrating the people who enslaved them, gave them the perception of freedom. Because we know all slaves did not go free in 1865. Some slaves weren't even freed up until the 1900s. And then after that, the prison system developed. These are just facts, but they'll call it emotionalism. Now, if those other people talk about the events with, you know, Hitler and the Nazis and, you know, all that stuff, that's perfectly fine. Never forget, never again. But if black people say anything about it, it's shut up. Your identity should be in Christ. You can't hold on to that. You must forget. Don't talk about it. It's CRT and emotionalism. Some of y'all that's on the fence gonna see the difference in the way they treat us. Y'all gonna see the difference in the way they act based on skin color. While they accuse people of teaching a skin doctrine, they hold a skin doctrine themselves. It's okay to treat black people like trash if they claim Israel, but if you're a Jew for Jesus, you're welcomed in the church. Assist states, localities, and nonprofit organizations to further the commemoration and coordinate for the public scholarly research of the arrivals of Africans in the United States and their contributions to this country. Well, that's what blackhistoryinthebible.com does. And you see them attacking me for putting out that information, but Congress established something to put out that information, and you don't hear none of these black Christians saying nothing about Congress and this 400-year act, even though the 400-year act, the commission was established to do the very thing that blackhistoryinthebible.com is doing. Shout out to all the curators on blackhistoryinthebible.com. Section 5, the commission may provide grants to communities and nonprofit organizations for the development of programs. 2, grants to research scholarly organizations to research, publish, or distribute information relating to the arrival of Africans in the United States, and the technical assistance to states, localities, and nonprofit organizations to further the commemoration. Exactly what I've been doing on blackhistoryinthebible.com, exactly what the curator's been doing on blackhistoryinthebible.com. But you don't hear none of these black Christians saying nothing about it. They have a problem with me, but they don't have a problem with Congress. The commission must prepare a strategic plan and submit a final report to Congress that contains a summary of its activities, an accounting of its received and expended funds, and its recommendations. The commission shall terminate July 1st, 2020. That was quick. All expenditures of the commission shall be made solely from donated funds. So they established a fund, but all the funds had to be donated. Sounds exactly like Black History and the Bible. If y'all want to support, hit up the Patreon, patreon.com/Dante Fortson. Cash App, anytime, #BHITB. Shout out to everybody that has hit up the Cash App. I appreciate you. Same thing with the patrons, all the new patrons. Welcome. Thank you for becoming a patron. And Super Chat. While we're live, you can hit that Super Chat button and support right now while we are live, or anytime in the future when we're live. PayPal link is in the description. Crypto links, wallet addresses are in the description. Shout out to the brother that sent the Bitcoin. He sent me Bitcoin through Cash App, because I guess you could send, Ben could have did it, but I've never done it. Send crypto through Cash App to somebody else. My mom actually did it a couple times. She told me about it, but I have never done it. So shout out to that brother. And if anybody wants to send any Bitcoin, like anything like that, you can send it via Cash App. All right. So now we've read what the HR 1242 is established to do. It's established by Congress. There is a 400-year period in America that happened concerning people that have been enslaved and oppressed. This is a historic fact. You cannot say that we have not been oppressed or enslaved. That's historic fact. So one more time in Genesis. And he said unto Abram, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs. That's key. If you go back and watch the whole series, I point out why that's a key. And shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. And also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge. And afterward shall they come out with great substance. So now let me move this forward a little bit. And I'm going to pour out a dose of medicine and see why we're We're going to talk some more. I showed you guys Perry Stone last time. I'm going to show him again this time. And we're going to talk a little bit about why this medicine is so important. Why it's so important to compare Egypt to the United States. And just a reminder, Berean and some of these other black Christians on here have been talking about Leaky Camp Doctrine. Leaky Camp Doctrine. Alton Johnson specifically says that the way we teach Deuteronomy and the way we teach the Old Testament, that's from the camps, and they want to blame one West. But I'm about to pour out a bottle of some medicine from the big white bottle. So the next time Alton or anybody on Berean's channel says that, you'll know that they're a lying, deceiving devil. So let me go ahead and cue this up, and I'll be right back. All right, got everything queued up. Here we go. I want y'all to listen carefully to what he's about to say. I'm probably going to play this twice for y'all. I'm going to play it twice for y'all. Fair use.
Played out before
now
us.
Comment also, okay, here comes Pharaoh. He doesn't understand the Hebrew people. And I think a person would have to be totally willfully blind to it or not see it because they haven't kept up with it, that we have had leadership in our country that's been very anti-Israel. Mm-hmm. The decisions they've made have been against Israel. There's even been talks, which I never thought I'd hear this, of sanctioning Israel because of decisions that some of the leadership in America does not agree with, okay? Having said that...
Hold on. He said the country's been very anti-Israel. What's interesting is he's not talking about us as a people. He's talking about those other people while ignoring the treatment of the very people he shares citizenship with in the same country.
The Pharaoh arose who knew not Joseph was read in the synagogue, the Torah portion, 2009, the week of the inauguration, that's and right. We predicted that there would be an Egyptian pattern developed. Now, what?
Hold on. He predicted that there would be an Egyptian pattern based on the Torah. He's using the Torah as Bible prophecy. So when you see these liars, these deceivers, these devils show up on Berean TV and other Christian channels talking about this is a one West doctrine, point them right back to this. The Parallels of America and Ancient Egypt, episode 753. This is March 13th, 2015. So ask when the camps developed the doctrine, and then ask them when Perry Stone came up with the doctrine. So either Perry Stone is teaching Leaky Camp Doctrine, or somebody over there is lying about the origin of this teaching. If you go back and watch this whole series, 400 years of teaching Deuteronomy 28, I believe that's episode 8 in this series, I pull up documents, historical documentation that Europeans have been teaching this since at least the 1600s, the Torah as prophecy. So let's continue.
Immediately begin to happen is taxes were increased. That's the taskmasters that are mentioned. But it also mentioned that this particular leader in Egypt passed a law to actually abort children. Mm-hmm. So one of the first things that happened in 2009 was the new leader reversed a law and kind of opened the doors to abortion all over the place.
Partial birth abortions.
Yeah, partial birth, etc. And this was very much like the Pharaoh pattern. Let's go from there again. Let's keep developing it, because I want people to see that this is something we're not talking about after the fact. We're talking about, Bill and I talked about this in 2008 and 9. I said we're going to go the pattern of ancient Egypt.
All right. So now he said that they had been talked about this in 2008, 2009, that America was going to go the pattern of ancient Egypt. This is why we're talking about the 400 years, because many people in the church will say that 400 years applied to Egypt. They ignore the Septuagint and any other translation that says 215 in Canaan, 215 in Egypt, because they have a narrative to push. The 400 years happening at another time point doesn't fit their narrative. And so what they do is they listen to these pastors and preachers and everybody else who tell them how to interpret the Bible. And instead of reading it for themselves and saying, wait a minute, that doesn't make sense, they just believe it and then they continue to pass it on. And meanwhile, they'll tell Israelites, we're taking the Bible out of context, we're not interpreting the Bible right. And while they're saying that, they have amillennialism and they have dispensationalism. Now, amillennialism and dispensationalism are not reconcilable beliefs. They teach two completely different things about Bible prophecy. But then Berean will say, well, we all believe the essentials. Well, maybe, because everybody's essentials aren't the same. Brother Jada Producer already brought that out and exposed that, that everybody's essentials list is not the same. But I want y'all to tag Berean. I want y'all to tell Berean. I want y'all to timestamp this for Berean. Berean would have to be telling us that if, as long as you believe on the Lord, as long as you believe on the Lord, his death, burial, and resurrection, that you can teach anything you want to about everything else. Because they'll say that's secondary. Well, amillennialism and dispensationalism are two completely different doctrines. The only thing that they agree about is salvation. So, Berean, are you telling me that no matter what you believe, as long as you believe in Christ, you can false teach the rest of the book? Because one of them views is wrong. One of them views is 100% absolutely, unequivocally false. Amillennialism and dispensationalism are not true. Both of them can't be true at the same time. Only one of them can be true. So, Berean, are you saying that you can false teach the whole book as long as you get the part about Christ right? At what point do we call somebody a false teacher? How do we define a false teacher? At what point do we call all these denominations out as false teachers? Because there are thousands of denominations that identify as Christian. I know y'all want to separate yourselves from some of them. I know y'all want to do that. But I suggest if they want to be separated, like from the TV preachers, they'll say that's not Christianity. That's not biblical Christianity. Maybe not. But the fact is, that's what people see. Just like they like to associate Israelites with the camps on the corner because that's what the media shows. So we associate many people in the black church with the clowns on TV because that's what the media shows. But y'all will get mad. I'm not even going to play the clip of Berean getting mad and saying he's done with Israel and calling us all devils and false teachers because we don't want to separate them. Meanwhile, they didn't want to separate us. So how about this? If you want to be separate from the teachers on TV, we'll just refer to y'all as moderates. That's what we're going to call y'all from now on, moderates. So all y'all Israelites listening, from now on, Berean TV and the other Christians on his channel that don't want to be associated with the TV circus, we're going to call them moderates, just like they call us when we don't want to be associated with the stuff we see on the corner with some Israelites on the corner. They want to call us moderates. So if that term is acceptable for y'all to use towards other people, it's acceptable for y'all to take on as a term as well. So from now on, we need to refer to them as moderates if they want to separate themselves from the buffoonery we see on TV. But let's continue. I'm going to play this one more time for you guys.
Actually, abort children. Mm-hmm. So one of the first things that happened in 2009 was the new leader reversed a law and kind of opened the doors to abortion all over the place.
Partial birth abortions.
Yeah, partial birth, etc. And this was very much like the Pharaoh pattern. Let's go from there again. Let's keep developing that because I want people to see that this is something we're not talking about after the fact. We're talking about, Bill and I talked about this in 2008 and 9, I said we're going to go the pattern of ancient Egypt.
All right. He mentioned abortions. We're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about the death of the firstborn in Egypt. We're going to talk about all these patterns. Perry Stone, even though some of them will say, well, he's a heretic. Well, Perry Stone identified as Christian. If y'all, he's a TV preacher. If y'all don't want to be associated with it, like I said, we will gladly call y'all moderates just like y'all call us. So Perry Stone talks about abortion. They're using the Old Testament as a blueprint for what's happening in modern times. That's important because when we do it, they say we're taking the Bible out of context. So let's go look at this harsh bondage. All right, I went ahead and pulled up Exodus. We're going to look at harsh bondage because that's something else that America has in common with ancient Egypt. We're going to go down to verse 8 and we're going to read down to verse 14. This is what Perry Stone and them are talking about, the new king. They're using the book of Exodus to predict events out of the Bible. I'm not using the book of Exodus. I'm just showing comparisons to America and ancient Egypt. They mentioned patterns. I'm going to mention patterns. Now there arose a new king over Egypt, which knew not Joseph. And he said unto his people, behold, the people of the children of Israel are more and mightier than we. Come on, let us deal wisely with them, lest they multiply and it come to pass that when there falleth out any war, they join also unto our enemies and fight against us, and so get them up out of the land. So let me pause right there. So there's a conspiracy because the people were more and mightier. If we do some digging, I'm going to bring some of this research out later, we'll find that in many parts of the South, Negroes outnumbered some of the whites, and in some places it was 50-50. And so they had a plan for that. But we're going to keep going. So the harsh bondage is going to come. So verse 11, therefore they did set over them taskmasters to afflict them with their burdens. Now you'll hear Perry Stone and the other guy on there say that these are tax masters. They try to take they try to separate the slavery part from it. But again, we don't agree on who the people are that they're referring to, but the events line up with us. So we know what happened here in America. And they built for Pharaoh treasure cities, Pithom and Ramses. So I'm not saying that Israelites built the Great Pyramids or the Sphinx or any of that stuff. It says they built treasure cities, Pithom and Ramses. So what happens when you have a second Egypt like America? You need to go get you some Israelites to build you a treasure nation, because America wanted to be greater than Egypt. But we saw Egypt, Egyptomania. America had an obsession with Egypt. It says, but the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied and grew, and they were grieved because of the children of Israel. And the Egyptians made the children of Israel to serve with rigor or harsh bondage. It says it right here. And they made their lives bitter with hard bondage in mortar and in brick and in all manner of service in the field. All their service wherein they made them serve was with rigor. And we read some of the quotes before on the last one. Go watch part 9 to this series, where it talked about people saying this was worse than the Egyptian slavery. And so now we're going to move into, so they served with rigor, but now we're going to move into, let me make sure I do this in the right spot. Okay, now we're going to move into the command to kill the children. He just mentioned abortion during the time of Pharaoh, and he talks about abortion, and their whole thing is, you know, going in on Obama. But he talks about abortion being one of the patterns of ancient Egypt, or the death of the males. So let me go ahead and read this, and then we're going to look at a few things, and then we're going to take some more medicine, a little bit more medicine. All right, verse 15, and the king of Egypt spake to the Hebrew midwives, of which the name of one was Shiphrah, and the name of the other Puah. And he said, when ye do the office of a midwife to the Hebrew women, and see them upon the stools, if it be a son, then ye shall kill him. But if it be a daughter, then she shall live. So we see there's already a plan to get rid of the men. Many people have pointed this out about the Democratic Party. That's what Perry Stone and this other guy are trying to point out. They're trying to specifically lay it on Obama. But the Democratic Party in general has always been for getting the men out of the black home. You see, the 94 crime bill was meant to lock up all the men, all the black men. And then you see the 96 welfare reform, where a woman could get more money from welfare if she did not have a man in the house. And so you see this move to get rid of the men. And then on top of that, you have abortion mixed into all this. So this plot to get rid of the males has been in play since the Exodus. I guess that's emotionalism, talking about, you know, things that are in the Bible and comparing them to real world circumstance. They're going to call that emotionalism, as if we're supposed to care. You guys know what it is when you don't have any emotions. You are a sociopath. So basically, when you hear them talk about emotionalism and using emotions and all this other stuff, they're basically recommending that you become sociopaths when you read the Bible, because you have to take all emotion out of it, everything. Everything you do, you have to take the emotion out of it. Otherwise, it's emotionalism. Just understand the doctrine that they are teaching. So before we get into this other bottle of white medicine, or this big white bottle, we're going to look at something. And I'm going to show you something funny. Well, it's not really funny. It's more so very telling. And somebody going to have to take responsibility for something. I'm gonna show y'all. All right, I went and pulled up a Planned Parenthood fact sheet. Now I want y'all to listen real closely to what I'm about to say, because we're talking about similarities between Egypt and America. Ancient Egypt, modern America. Now, on this fact sheet, I think it's funny that Planned Parenthood is in denial of what we know to be true about history. And unfortunately, Black Democrats have pushed this on the community. But more specifically, the Black church is responsible for this happening in the community. They want to, hold on, we're going. They want to push the narrative that they've been so helpful to the Black community, but they don't want to talk about the harm that they've done to the Black community through pushing Democrats and abortion on us. So let's talk about this. Opposition claims to Margaret Sanger. This is October 2004. Now, Sanger's outreach to the African American community. I'm gonna read the highlighted portion down here, but I wanna read some of this right here. Harlem in the 1930s. In 1930, Sanger opened a family planning clinic in Harlem that sought to enlist support for contraceptive use and to bring the benefits of family planning to women who were denied access to their city's health and social services. Staffed by a Black physician and Black social worker, the clinic was endorsed by the Amsterdam News, the powerful local newspaper, the Abyssinian Baptist Church, the Urban League, and the Black community elder statesman W.E.B. Du Bois. Chesler, 1992. So who? The Abyssinian Baptist Church, the Urban League, and W.E.B. Du Bois. You're going to see the churches pop up a lot in this abortion scheme, this mass genocide that was pushed on us by these devils. And the Black church was the weak link through which they knew to go. You don't go through the strongest link to push genocide to a community. You go through the weakest link. Negro Project, 1939 and 1942. Y'all Google the Negro Project if you don't know anything about it. Beginning in 1939, Du Bois served on an advisory council for Sanger's Negro Project, which was designed to serve African Americans in the rural South. They're cleaning it up. The advisory council called it a unique experiment in race building and humanitarian service to a race subjected to discrimination, hardship, and segregation. And they're trying to make it like she's so nice and loving to the Black community. Y'all gonna see something in a second. The Black church needs to own up to something. In a letter to philanthropist Albert Lasker, from whom she hoped to raise funds for the project, Sanger wrote that she wanted to help a group of notoriously unprivileged and handicapped to a large measure by a caste system, oppression, that operates as an added weight upon their efforts to get a fair share of the better things established by Margaret Sanger and people like her. King, 1966. Hold on, here we go. Was Sanger racially motivated? Despite the admiration that African American heroes like Du Bois, Powell, and King held for Sanger, arguments continue about whether or not her outreach to the Black community was racially motivated. The patriarchal racism of the social policy of the time and well-intentioned paternalism of philanthropists to lift up African Americans may have influenced Sanger, but there is no evidence that Sanger or the Federation intended to coerce Black women into using birth control. Pay attention to what I said. There is no evidence that Sanger or the Federation intended to coerce Black women into using birth control. The fundamental belief underscored at every meeting, mentioned in much of the behind-the-scenes correspondence and evident in all the printed material put out by the Division of Negro Service, by the Division of Negro Service, was that uncontrolled fertility presented the greatest burden to the poor, and Southern Blacks were among the poorest Americans. So you need to control your reproduction. The people are mightier than we. What did it say there? Let me go back up. He said unto his people, behold, the people of the children of Israel are more and mightier than we. Come on, let us deal with them wisely, lest they multiply, and it come to pass that when there falleth out any war, they join us all. They join also unto our enemies and fight against us, and so get them up out of the land. So they wanted to stop the growth of Israel. And we saw that they put him under harsh bondage and began to or ordered the murder of the male children. Y'all go do some research on what happened to the Black Panthers and Lyndon B. Johnson and how much money they spent to stop the rise of a black messiah. So anyway, they want these poor, they want to help these poor black people stop reproducing. In fact, the Negro Project did not differ very much from the earlier birth control campaigns in the rural South. So why was it called the Negro Project then? Why not just call it Planned Parenthood like you do now? It would have been more racist in Sanger's mind to ignore African Americans in the South than to fail at trying to raise the health and economic standards of their communities. Birth control or race control, 2001. So now, this is again, Planned Parenthood. There'll be a link to this. Planned Parenthood's fact sheet in an attempt to, you know, cover up, to sugarcoat. So now, Time Magazine. What Margaret Sanger really said about eugenics and race. This is Margaret Sanger. Let me go down. I think I highlighted something. Maybe I didn't highlight. All right, so I did want to read a small piece on this. Actually, down here it says historians and scholars who've examined Sanger's correspondence, as Salon reported in 2011, challenged those who call the activists racist. Much of the controversy stems from a 1939 letter in which Sanger outlined her plan to reach out to black leaders, specifically ministers, to help dispel community suspicions about the family planning clinics she was opening in the South. So she wanted to reach out to the ministers or pastors or people in the black church so that they could get the black community to accept legal genocide, aka abortion. Why? Because she saw them as the weakest link. You don't go through the strongest link in the black community. Notice she didn't push this to the Muslims. She didn't push this to the Nation of Islam. The plan wasn't to push it to any Muslims, any black Muslims, anybody like that. I don't even know if the Nation of Islam was around back then. I'm pretty sure it was. However, she didn't push it to none of them. She went to the black church. We do not want word. This is a quote. We do not want word to go out that we want to exterminate the Negro population. And the minister is the man who can straighten out that idea if it ever occurs to any of their more rebellious members. So she already thought that the thought might occur. That Negroes, rebellious Negroes, you know, the ones against her, the ones that are against their narrative, those are the rebellious Negroes. So they needed somebody in place, the gatekeepers, to control the rebellious Negroes that might dare speak out against abortion as a plan to wipe out the black race. So they were already engaged in counterintelligence from the beginning. And they thought that the ministers in the black church were the people to go to get their agenda pushed. She wrote, it was, as the Washington Post called it, an artfully written sentence, but one that in context describes the sort of preposterous allegations she feared, not her actual mission. The irony is that it has been used to propagate those very allegations. Cruz's letter to the director of the National Portrait Gallery, for example, quotes only the first half of the sentence. So now, they're saying that people are taking it out of context. She wasn't really racist. It's no big deal. They only used half of the sentence, and you'll hear a lot of black Democrats try to defend this. But let's keep going. Hold on. I'm not done yet. Let me move this out my way. Link will be in the description. Make sure y'all hit that thumbs up. Make sure y'all share this video. This is from USA Today. So wait, this was that first one was 2004. That came from Planned Parenthood. This is from 2016. We know what was going on again. That's an election. It was election year, if I recall correctly. Remove statues of Margaret Sanger, Planned Parenthood founder tied to eugenics and racism. How a woman who advocated for the selective breeding of her fellow citizens came to be memorialized with those who built a country is hard to understand. Right. Selective breeding of her fellow citizens. Let me see. Did I highlight anything here? All right. I know where I wanted to stop at. So let me come up here. Let's right here. For those identifying historical figures with racist roots who should be removed from public view because of their evil histories. Planned Parenthood's founder, Margaret Sanger, must join that list. In promoting birth control, she advanced a controversial Negro project, wrote in her autobiography about speaking to a Ku Klux Klan group, and advocated for a eugenics approach to breeding for the gradual suppression, elimination, and eventual extinction of defective stocks, those human weeds which threaten the blooming of the finest flowers of American civilization. Just remember, they got a plan for you. They got a plan for you. Those Democrats out there are supporting this. The Republicans aren't supporting Planned Parenthood. I'm not telling you to vote Democrat or Republican. I keep telling y'all know what you're voting for. In 1939, a letter to Dr. C.J. Gamble, Sanger urged him to get over his reluctance to hire a full-time Negro physician. Listen why. As the colored Negroes can get closer to their own members and more or less lay their cards on the table, which means their ignorance, superstitions, and doubt. Like the abortion lobby today, Sanger urged Dr. Gamble to enlist the help of spiritual leaders to justify their deadly work, writing, "We do not want word to go out that we want to exterminate the Negro population, and the minister is the man who can straighten out the idea if it ever occurs to any of their more rebellious members." We just read that. And that spirit of racism continues today, as more than 300 former and current employees of Planned Parenthood said recently in an open letter, noting a toxic environment. Planned Parenthood was founded by a racist white woman. That is part of history that cannot be changed, they observed, writing that the pattern of systematic racism, pay inequity and lack of upward mobility for black staff continues. When was this written? This was written July 23rd, 2020. Oh, we're getting closer. We're getting closer to something. So now, I think it's time that the black church wants to take credit for how much good they've done and what they've built, and they've done more for the black community. Y'all hear Berean say it, but when are they ever going to take responsibility and repent for being used by these devils to push mass genocide into the black community through the Democrat Party and through Planned Parenthood? When are those devils ever going to admit to that? They won't. But let's continue, because I want y'all to see something from 2021, just last year. "I'm the head of Planned Parenthood. We're done making excuses for our founder. I don't want to hear a word from you black Democrats next time this gets brought up, because the head of Planned Parenthood is done making excuses for the founder. We must reckon with Margaret Sanger's association with white supremacist groups and eugenics." April 17th, 2021. "I don't want to hear another word from black Democrats on my channel about nothing to do with supporting Democrats. I don't care how evil you say Republicans are. It does not excuse Democrats. Pointing out Republican evil does not excuse the evil of the Democrats." We need to talk about Margaret Sanger. For the 11 years that I've been involved with Planned Parenthood, founded by Sanger, her legacy on race has been debated. Sanger, a nurse, opened the nation's first birth control clinic in Brownsville, Brooklyn, in 1916, and dedicated her life to promoting birth control to improve women's lives. But was she or was she not racist? It's a question that we've tried to avoid, but we no longer can. We must reckon with it. Up until now, Planned Parenthood has failed to own the impact of our founder's actions. That's why I read y'all that letter first from 2004. "We have defended Sanger as a protector of bodily autonomy and self-determination while excusing her association with white supremacist groups and eugenics as an unfortunate product of her time. Until recently, we have hidden behind the assertion that her beliefs were the norm for people of her class and era, always being sure to name her work alongside that of W.E.B. Du Bois and other black freedom fighters, but the facts are complicated." So that was intentional. And you guys saw me read that about W.E.B. Du Bois every single time I read something about Sanger. And they just admitted that that was their agenda, always being sure to name her work alongside that of W.E.B. Du Bois and other black freedom fighters. "Sanger spoke to a women's auxiliary of the Ku Klux Klan at a rally in New Jersey to generate support for birth control. And even though she eventually distanced herself from the eugenics movement because of its hard turn to explicit racism, she endorsed the Supreme Court's 1927 decision in Buck versus Bell, which allowed states to sterilize people deemed unfit without their consent and sometimes without their knowledge, a ruling that led to the sterilization of tens of thousands of people in the 20th century. The first human trials of the birth control pill, a project that was Sanger's passion later in life, were conducted with her backing in Puerto Rico, where as many as 1,500 women were not told that the drug was experimental or that they might experience dangerous side effects. You guys can go to the New York Times and finish reading this. But the fact is, this was 2021. Read that title one more time. I'm the head of Planned Parenthood. We're done making excuses for our founder. All right, so if the head of Planned Parenthood is done making excuses for the founder, you black Democrats out there should be done making excuses for the founder as well. Don't make no more excuses for Planned Parenthood, because, again, they're done making excuses for their own founder. So don't go harder for people than they go harder for themselves. So yeah, now we're gonna take a little bit more of this medicine. You know what? Not yet. Before we get to some more of this medicine, we're gonna come back to the Bible. So we talked about the harsh bondage. We talked about the assault on the children. Where are we gonna go? So now let's just talk about the order of events real quick, because since we're going, so the 400 years of captivity, during that 400 years, there's going to be a harsh bondage. There's assault on the males. But where does this take place? So now we're going to get back over to this chart, the chart that they intentionally used wrong on Berean TV, because they didn't bother to actually, you know, listen to how the chart was supposed to be used. They just grabbed it, looked at it, and started making all kind of ridiculous assumptions. In fact, hold on, let me cue up the video, because I want to play it before we go here. I want you guys to hear it. All right, here we go. We're going to start from here. Fair use.
Microphone. Go ahead.
Yeah, I don't.
I thought you were. All right, go ahead. I'm going to mute myself. I'm eating my right. I made me some food.
Yeah, go ahead. So I don't know how any of what Dante was, the prophecies and things that he was pointing out, proves that we, the black people, I mean, I don't. You know, get the connection. But
hold on, this is the ignorant brother I keep telling y'all about, the one that said he hasn't done no research but he don't believe it. Now, as y'all know, anybody with a brain that actually listened to why I put out the chart, they know that the chart is not to prove that Israel is black. The chart is to show which prophecies are mentioned and where they are mentioned in the Bible, scattered and removed into all nations and kingdoms on earth. This is where you can find it in scripture, to that ignorant brother who doesn't do research but makes up his mind. We read about that, what Proverbs calls that. It's a folly and a shame unto him. Berean, you need to educate that brother on what it means to act foolish and answer a matter before hearing it. So this is what the chart is for. It's not to prove that black people are Israel. It's to show Israel, slavery, end times, and the second coming. Every verse in the Bible where you will find references to these prophecies that we talk about. So anyway, let me go ahead and get back to it.
You know, some of the prophecies have been fulfilled, some of them haven't. I mean, we can dig into it if we really want to, but I don't see how that proves. But last night I caught some of the broadcasts, and folk were on here back to spiritualizing Egypt again, and it no longer became it's no longer a physical land, where, you know, Deuteronomy 28, going back to Egypt. America is a spiritual Egypt, because America has a lot of symbolisms of Egypt, like no other nation has symbolism in Egypt, just America. And
now hold on, he's mentioning Deuteronomy 28 because they have an agenda to try to pin it to the camps. But as I've showed you guys, there are European Christians that are using Torah to try to apply it to now, as if prophecies are contained in the Torah that will shed light on today's happenings.
Here's my question. So we talk about the bondage. We talk about the 400 years of bondage, people bringing up prison and all that. Okay, whatever. So let's go. The Emancipation Proclamation, excuse me. I think it's 18.
You're talking about the Emancipation Proclamation.
1865, whatever year that was put into place. Up to even 30, 40 years after that, you mean to tell me that Negroes, if they wanted to, could not have mass exited the United States after slavery was in it?
No. They could not have mass exited the United States after slavery was ended because they had nothing. They had no money, no means, no nothing. And so many of them were homeless. And J-Mac, I guess this is what the brother's name is, this ignorant dude clearly doesn't know much about anything. And why Berean has this ignorant dude on the panel, I have no clue. But no, they couldn't leave. We read the quote from Abraham Lincoln in the last part, part eight, the United States of Egypt, where Abraham Lincoln was pushing for the slave owners to send them back to Liberia, but he knew they wouldn't do it where they could sell them for $1,500 or more and make a profit off of them. So no, they didn't have means to go on their own. If they did, Abraham Lincoln never would have suggested that slave owners send them back. But let's keep going.
Went to wherever they wanted to go, Canada, South America, back, Europe, Africa.
Now, also remember that slavery was officially abolished in 1865. It did not stop in 1865. They act like slavery just ended. We know some people weren't free from slavery until the 1900s. And also we know that the 13th Amendment allowed you to put people back into slavery as a punishment for a crime. Y'all Google vagrancy laws if you have no idea what they are. In fact, let me pause this right here and I'm gonna Google them for you and read it. All right, I pulled up the vagrancy laws for you guys. Historically, vagrancy laws made it a crime for a person to wander from place to place without visible means of support. Basically, these laws criminalize being homeless and jobless. Historically, vagrancy laws made it a crime for a person to wander from place to place without visible means of support. Now, if we get into the history of the vagrancy laws, we'll know they popped up after slavery. We could go through this. This is, I don't want to get distracted with vagrancy laws, but no, they couldn't just go wherever they wanted to. Laws were made to put them back into slavery because the 13th Amendment, matter of fact, let me pull up the 13th Amendment. All right, here we go. 13th Amendment. I just Googled that. Constitution of the United States of America, 1789. Neither slavery, this is section one, neither slavery nor involuntary servitude. Oh, wait, let me read section one first. Neither slavery nor involuntary servitude, except as punishment for a crime whereof the party shall have been duly convicted, shall exist within the United States or any place to their subject to their jurisdiction. So if you have been convicted for a crime, slavery can be the punishment, which is why we talk about the criminal justice system, which is why they put you in shackles and handcuffs and have you working for little to no pay. Section 2, Congress shall have power to enforce this article by appropriate legislation. So Congress has the power to enforce involuntary servitude or slavery as means for a punishment for a crime. And yet some of these dudes are acting blind like we've been treated fairly in America all this time. They abolish slavery and then leave a loophole there. Y'all watch the documentary 13th if you don't know about it already. I got about another 2 minutes of this that I want to show you guys. Give me a second here.
Or anywhere else. Hey, I'm not an employee here, sir. Okay. Anywhere that they wanted to go. They couldn't have left and went. They had to stay here in bondage and suffer through Jim Crow and suffer through whatever.
Yes. Again, yes, because if you understand it like we understand it, if you're, instead of being in denial and being against something that you clearly have not researched because you said you didn't research it and you said you don't know about it, but this was a punishment from God, and it was a 400-year punishment. Not everybody believes it. Everybody don't have to believe it. But the fact is, we believe, some of us, not all of us, believe that it was a 400-year punishment, and we just read through that. Congress established there was 400 years. So explain to me why we don't see another 400-year bondage in history, specifically 400 years. God ain't working by coincidences or estimates or roundabouts. He didn't mean 215 in Canaan, 215 in Egypt, or 430 years. If he says 400, he means 400. And we just so happen to have a worldwide slavery of people who came from West Africa with Torah, speaking Hebrew, Arab. They have Hebrew names. Y'all go watch this whole series. They believe all of this is coincidence. And then a worldwide slavery happens. Congress acknowledges a 400-year period of slavery and oppression. And all these people are saying we're reading it wrong. We don't have no idea what we're talking about. And yet we keep bumping into all this information. Tell the truth, shame the devil. Let's keep going.
But no, but this is the time. That's why they have to be preached. Remember, Jesus said, the words that I speak unto you, that spirit and life. That's how people got to preach this awakening. Y'all upset because y'all running around here saying, oh, they always want to talk about Jesus. They got to preach the awakening. Just preaching Jesus and you must be born again ain't got to preach Israel. You got to wake up and come back to the law, statutes, and commandments.
Well, that's why I love.
Now, he said, we got to preach this awakening. I want to hold Brother Berean accountable for every word he says right now. He said, we got to preach this awakening. But he's going to say something else in a minute that I'm going to come back to. I'm going to stop it just short of that. But I want y'all to tag Berean. I want him to watch this. I want him to watch this in its entirety. These ain't even blowing shots at Berean. I'm going to play Berean's own words that he has to say about me specifically. I'm going to play Berean's own word, and then I'm going to give him two doses of the medicine from the white bottle.
Of Elder Green. Elder Green's an Israelite, but he don't go around preaching this stuff. He preached the gospel, and that's what we were commissioned to do. Now I'm
pausing it one more time. They talk about this commission to preaching the gospel stuff. You see, Jay the producer got a whole studio set up. Who taught him how to do that? I guess you can't learn that, and if somebody wants to know it, you can't teach nobody about that. If you have a job, you can't learn that. What do teachers do? What do Christian teachers do? Are they supposed to teach the gospel at their job? Are they supposed to teach the gospel 24/7? Are there exceptions to when you can and can't or should or shouldn't preach the gospel? I guarantee you they won't tell somebody to preach the gospel, even if it'll get them fired from their job. And yet, when we talk about something as you know, hobbyists or enthusiasts or people who are interested in a subject, somebody who's interested in DNA, oh, you can't talk about that, you got to preach Jesus. Well, why aren't you telling that to the Christian biologist that's talking about DNA for 8 hours a day when they're getting paid to do it? Why aren't you giving us the same exact message that you're giving European Christians who do the same exact thing? Why is it okay for Black History Month for you guys to teach Black history for a month straight, but if Israelites talk about Black history, suddenly that's more important than Christ? See, they're painting a narrative. They want to tell people what's more important to them. These people are liars and devils, and I'm calling it for what it is. I'm not sugarcoating none of this today.
I'm not saying that there's anything wrong with anyone studying history. I totally understand that, and I get that. You know, lineage, history, and that's cool. But to make a doctrine out of it?
See, that's another false narrative they push, is that somehow we're making history a doctrine. See, they want to lie to people and tell them this is a doctrine. No, we're talking about history just like many of y'all do during Black History Month. And if that's the case, whenever y'all talk about history, it's also a doctrine. You can't say one group is making it a doctrine, but everybody else is just history when they talk about it. They want to push this false narrative on Black people specifically. Go watch my video, Preachers of a Different Gospel. This defines what they're doing.
I'm not making doctrine. If I find out that I'm a Mandingo, I'm not going to make a doctrine out of it. You know, I would love to be able to make a movie like Alex Haley did, but I can't. You know, I don't have those kind of resources. I mean, I don't get that.
So he just said he would love. He said he wouldn't make it a doctrine, but he would love to make a movie about it. He just don't have the resources to do it. I just want y'all to hear stuff like that.
Well, when I talk about commandments, I'm not talking about keeping the tefillin and all that kind of stuff.
I'm still trying to find out how everybody on the house a house resolution bill that gives you the 400 years and nobody's going to ask the United States Congress how they came up with their numbers.
All right, shout out to Brother Sean Harris. He was the one that brought up that 400 years, which prompted me to pull up that document. I've mentioned it before, but that was the document right here is the document that he sent them over. Now watch what Brother Jay the producer says, completely missing the point, and then J-Mac is going to throw something in there this Brother Sean Harris did not say. Shout out to Sean.
The brother just read it to you. It don't say what you think it does.
See, right there, it don't say what you think it does. They made an assumption about what he thinks it says. See, it's that reading comprehension narrative that they want to push because these people are lying devils. All he did was say, stop asking us about the 400 years and ask Congress, which they won't do. We know they're not going to do it because they want to say Israel's wrong because we're Black. They'll treat us different and say we're Black. Well, it didn't happen in 1619. It really happened in 15, whatever. They'll come up with all these different dates. But when it comes to Congress, all of a sudden they acting stupid like they don't know how to get in touch with Congress. They don't know how to write their local congressman and ask them. And then they'll say, oh, well, they came up with it in 1619. But then they play dumb like they don't know how we came up with 1619.
I know it's cold because we say it. But you go ask them how they came up with that number.
They calculated from 1619 when the slaves were right. They tell you in the document how they got 400 years from the time that they put the document in place, dating back to 1619. They did this thing commemorating 400 years that Africans been in this country, like just in general.
All right, so he says just in general. Jada Producer is playing stupid. Jada Producer's from Texas. Jada Producer knows the history of racism in this country. Jada Producer then got up there and said the church hasn't addressed certain things concerning certain oppressions. And sometimes I have a lot of respect for Jada Producer, and sometimes I just wonder, like, how do you get up there and say certain things and then turn around and act completely brain dead and oblivious to everything else that's being said? So I have a love-hate relationship with my personal opinion on Jada Producer. I do agree with him at times. I agree with Berean at times. I don't agree with every Israelite, but I agree with some Israelites at times, and I agree with many black Christians at times. So this right here, Jada Producer says, well, you know, it's just talking about black people in general. Well, we know what the history of black people since 1619 in this country has been. It's been slavery and oppression, just like we read in the book of Genesis, just like they did to the people in the book of Exodus. So now I'm going to stop right there because I wanted you guys to hear that. So now, after this 400, well, let me get to the where this slavery and oppression is supposed to happen. It's supposed to happen in a land that is not theirs. I'm not going to get too much into that because we did that in a previous study. But number five, scattered into a land they did not know. So now in Genesis 15, 13, let's get back over here to the Bible. All right, in Genesis 15, verse 13, he said unto Abram, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs and shall serve them. And they shall afflict them 400 years. So they will be strangers in the land that is not theirs. They will say that's Egypt. Okay, so let's pretend like you guys don't have a reading comprehension problem. Let's pretend like you guys are telling the truth. Let's pretend like all this was fulfilled in Genesis. Now, let's talk about the problem you have when you pretend that's the case. So now, let's go to Deuteronomy 28:36. This is after they come out of Egypt. Deuteronomy 28:36. Let's go there. Verse 36. And the Lord shall bring thee and thy king. That study's coming because they think they're clever, saying, well, what king went into slavery? We got to answer for that. Anyway. And thy king, which thou shalt set over thee, unto a nation which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, and there shall thou serve other gods, wood and stone. So wait a minute. They just came out of Egypt. Neither them nor their fathers have known. Is it talking about their direct fathers, or is it talking about the Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob type of fathers, their forefathers? Because Abraham was from Ur of the Chaldees, which many people believe was around Iraq. And then he traveled over to Canaan, and then he traveled into Egypt, and then he traveled back out to Canaan. Go look at Abraham's journey. So if it's talking about their forefathers, it has to be in a land they didn't know. This couldn't be talking about Egypt because they just came out of Egypt. But let's keep going. Let's keep talking about the problem that they're going to have. Let's go over here to the book of Jeremiah, chapter 5, 19. Jeremiah, they'll try to say, well, this talking about Babylon or Egypt. They come up with all kind of different stuff. So Jeremiah 5:19. Jeremiah combines words from Deuteronomy, and Jeremiah combines words from Genesis. And it shall come to pass. Not it has already passed. Not this was fulfilled. It shall come to pass when ye shall say, wherefore or why doeth the Lord our God these things unto us? Then shall thou answer them, like as ye have forsaken me and served strange gods in your land, so shall ye serve strangers in a land that is not yours. Wait a minute. Ain't that what Genesis said? A land that is not theirs, they shall It says, "Know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them." Now we get all the way to the prophet Jeremiah, who's talking about a future event, and he's using the same words. "And it shall come to pass, when ye shall say, whereof, wherefore doeth the Lord our God all these things unto us, then shall thou answer them, like as ye have forsaken me, and serve strange gods in your land, so shall ye serve strangers in a land that is not yours." One more time for the black Christians in the back that act like we're taking it out of context. "So shall ye serve strangers in a land that is not yours." So now while we're still pretending that the Genesis reference explains what happened in Egypt, please explain to me what Jeremiah is talking about. Please explain to me what land Jeremiah is talking about, because y'all love to say, well, Genesis refers to the Egyptian captivity. Well, tell me what future captivity Jeremiah is talking about in a land that's not theirs. How many times does Israel go serve in a land that's not theirs? Let's keep looking. Number five, we're going to go to Jeremiah chapter 9, verse 16. We're going to see. And my chart, by the way, is in chronological order by date. It's not the order the Bible gives us. As you can see, the dates are right here. So Genesis around 1445 BC. And then we get over here to Jeremiah is around 586 BC. And then we're going to get to Zechariah around 480 BC. So we're getting further and further out. But let's go to Jeremiah 9:16 real quick. I did a whole study on this. I'm not going to go through all of these. I'm just showing you a couple. "I will scatter them also among the heathen, whom neither they nor their fathers have known, and I will send a sword after them till I have consumed them." We have gone over all of this in previous studies on the Deuteronomy, Beyond Deuteronomy 28 series. We'll look at two more. Jeremiah 17:4, and then we're going to look at Zechariah 7:14. So we'll go to Jeremiah 17:4. Let me see if I got to type this whole thing in. Jeremiah 17, verse 4. "And thou, even thyself, shall discontinue from thine heritage." We'll get into more of that later about forgetting. Shout out to Jordan for bringing that out, if they bethink themselves. We know about Psalms 83 to make Israel forget, be forgotten as a nation. We see it. They want us to believe that we're crazy. We're taken out of context. "And thou, even thyself, shall discontinue from thine heritage that I gave thee, and I will cause thee to serve thine enemies in a land which thou knowest not, for ye have kindled a fire in mine anger, which shall burn forever." Wait a minute. He said this is going to burn forever. Let's go. Let me see. Is Deuteronomy still in here? Let me make sure. Deuteronomy 28. Let me pull this up. "And they shall be upon thee for a sign and for a wonder, and upon thy seed forever." So these curses, you know, after God gets mad for Israel disobeying, are supposed to be a sign and a wonder forever. And then we read in Jeremiah 17 over here that the Lord's anger, which shall burn forever. And we don't mean past the time that Christ comes. They like to play games with these words. Forever meaning up until Christ puts an end to it. So let's look at the last one in the book of Zechariah chapter 7, verse 14. And you guys can go through, get this chart yourself. Again, the chart link will be in the description. "But I scattered them with a whirlwind among all the nations, whom they knew not. Thus the land was desolate after them, that no man passed through nor returned, for they laid the pleasant land desolate." So you guys can go through and read all this yourself. We're going to see that this happens, but they don't want to give us dates as to when these things are fulfilled. Remember, Zechariah is a prophet as well. So I want you to really pay attention to how these people use these verses. Now, let's keep going. They have to be taken into a land that they don't know. And then if we go back to Genesis chapter 15, let's go back here. Genesis chapter 15, the judgment. It says, "And also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterwards shall they come out with great substance." So you got to ask yourself, How many captivities in a land that they don't know? We read that they spend 400 years in a land that's not theirs, and they're afflicted for 400 years. If the people that came over on boats, if the Israelites that came over on boats to America didn't know America or the language, how does this prophecy not apply? Especially now that we see that Congress has acknowledged a 400-year period. How do you look at a worldwide slave trade? You acknowledge that there's Israelites in West Africa. You acknowledge that the transatlantic slave trade was a worldwide slave trade. Some of them try to downplay it like it wasn't. You acknowledge that what this says in the Bible right here, that they would be in a land that they don't know. And you know that those people in West Africa didn't know America. You know that it says they shall serve and afflict them for 400 years. You know that Congress signed the 400-year act. And y'all say that we crazy, we making it all up. None of this applies to us. So now we get to the judgments. And also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge. So we're going to come back over to this chart. We're going to go down to number 33, I believe it is. The nations or Gentiles judged where Israel is scattered and enslaved. We just read this. Exodus 6:6. We know in the Exodus that Egypt was judged. So let's go right here to Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 7. And we're going to see Deuteronomy 30, verse 7. Talks about the nations being judged. It says, "And the Lord thy God will put all these curses upon thine enemies and on them that hate thee, which persecuted thee." So this is after Israel turns back. Let me read from verse 1. We're going to read from verse 1 through 7. And the reason I'm reading this part is because I want y'all to understand something that Berean's about to say. I'm going to give Berean two shots of the medicine from the white bottle today. And this is because he chose these words. I didn't choose these words. He chose to get up on his platform and say this stuff. "And it shall come to pass when all these things are come upon thee." It shall come to pass when all these things are come upon thee, the blessing and the curse which I have set before thee, that thou shalt call them to mind among the nations whither the Lord thy God hath driven thee. We know that's what's going on right now with the awakening. Black people everywhere scattered among the nations where the Lord drove them. Us, Israel, are calling them to mind among these nations, which is why you see the awakening happening all over the world. But they want you to believe it's something of the devil, and it's just affecting black people. The devil only cares about black people. The devil only wants to mislead black people. The devil wants to put black people into slavery. The devil wants to oppress black people. Now the devil wants to steal black people's souls and keep us going to hell. Okay, cool. Deuteronomy 30 verse 2, "And shall return unto..." Let me see. So if these things come to mind, it says, "And shall return unto the Lord thy God, and shall obey his voice according to all that I command thee this day, thou and thy children, with all thine heart and with all thy soul." So he's telling them to turn back. He says, if you do this, if you turn back. But wait a minute, I thought G-Con gets up on Berean's channel and say the covenant has been broken. And his favorite thing is, well, if you don't pay your T-Mobile bill and you break your contract and then you go pay it, no, that contract is null and void, has been broken. But right here, God is saying, if you break the contract and you remember this and you turn back and shall obey the voice, his voice, according to all that I command thee this day, thou and thy children with all thy heart, with all thy soul, that then the Lord thy God will turn thy captivity. So he has made promises and have compassion upon thee and will return and gather thee from all nations whither the Lord thy God hath scattered thee. That has not happened yet. Why? Because Israel has not turned back yet. Now, they want to say that's camp doctrine, but I'm going to give y'all two big old bottles to give them a dose with next time they say that nonsense. "If any of thine be driven out to the outmost parts of the heaven, from thence will the Lord thy God gather thee, and from thence will he fetch thee. And the Lord thy God will bring thee into the land which thy fathers possessed, and thou shalt possess it, and he will do thee good and multiply thee above thy fathers." Let's keep going. "And the Lord thy God will circumcise thine heart and the heart of thy seed to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, that thou mayest live." Now remember, this is an addendum to the covenant. He's saying, if you turn back, even if you mess up and you turn back, I'll still hold up my end of the bargain. They don't want to talk about that. And the Lord thy God will put these curses upon thine enemies and on them that hate thee, which persecuted thee. Y'all better be real careful about boasting against the natural branches. Some of y'all are going to be in trouble. Because he said he's going to put the curses on the enemies and on them that hate Israel and persecuted Israel. Unless you can show me when that happened, that has not been fulfilled. And I know they're going to come up with some nonsense that don't fit, that don't actually fit the prophecies. And thou shalt return and obey the voice of the Lord and do all his commandments, which I commanded thee this day. I get it. Y'all got liberty to do whatever y'all want to. So the judgments, let's keep going. We're not going to look at all these. We have this in Joel 3. You guys can read that. It's mentioned again in Micah 5. Isaiah 11, Isaiah 41. You guys have it here. You guys can download this chart for free. But over here in Revelation 18, verses 4 through 6 and 13. Let's go to Revelation 18. We'll read that. The whole book of Revelation is judgment. They want to play dumb, like they don't understand what the day of the Lord is. A day with the Lord is 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. It explains that, and then they talk about an event called the day of the Lord, and then we see 1,000-year reign of Christ, and they say, oh, wait, the 1,000-year reign, that don't have nothing to do with the day of the Lord. And then we have John saying, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day in Greek, which is the equivalent to the day of the Lord in Hebrew, but they don't get it. It has nothing to do with each other. It's a coincidence. All this stuff is random information in the book. And we need to get an esoteric reinterpretation of it like the amillennialist view gives us. All right, we're going to read verses 4 through 6 and 13. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues. For her sins have reached unto heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities. Reward her even as she rewarded you, and double unto her double according to her works, in the cup which she hath filled to fill to her double. And then this is the curses being put on them. And we'll keep going. How much she hath glorified herself and lived deliciously, so much torment and sorrow give her. For she saith in her heart, I sit a queen and am no widow and shall see no sorrow. Therefore shall her plagues come in one day, death and mourning and famine, and she shall be utterly burned with fire. For strong is the Lord God who judges her. When he says, come out of her, my people, is he talking to Israel? Is he talking to the church? Let's go down to verse 13. Let me see. Now, this is talking about what's in this Babylon they're talking about. We're going to come back to Babylon because there are some European preachers who believe Babylon is America. And they'll say, which is it? Is it Egypt or is it Babylon? Like almost taunting, boasting against the natural branches as if we're stupid. And yet you will see Europeans that teach that it is both Egypt and Babylon here in America. We also see in Revelation that Jerusalem is called spiritual Edom, spiritual Sodom and spiritual Egypt. It's referred to as two different cities. And yet they act like America can't be both Babylon and Egypt, but Jerusalem can be both Sodom and Egypt. So anyway, verse 13, and cinnamon, this is what's in Babylon, and odors or future Babylon, and ointments and frankincense and wine and oil and fine flour and wheat and beast and sheep and horses and chariots and slaves and souls of men. They had slaves and souls of men in this future city that's going to be destroyed. That could be anywhere. However, we'll keep going because we're not going to get into Mystery Babylon or Babylon the Great or any of that right now. So now if we go back to the book of Genesis, so we've talked about judgments. Let's just look at some stuff real quick since we did talk about judgments. Let's go here. A timeline of the you know, that thing we don't talk about. That thing that'll get us flagged. The timeline right here, y'all see the word, of these developments in 2020. They want to say nothing happened. The 400 years is up, and we were supposed to be out of here according to their narrative that they want to tell people that we're pushing, which is a lie. And again, any person who says that all Israelites believe that we were going to be out of here after the 400 years is a liar, a deceiver, and a devil. I'm making it plain. So here's a timeline of events. So 2019, 1619 to 2019 was 400 years. Many of us pointed that out. We just read in the book that after the 400 years, that nation's going to be judged. And so let's just look at a timeline of some of the events. January 9th. So this is right after 2019. Some people, now some Israelites said it was going to happen in August. Some people believe that's when the 400 years ended, was in August. And some of those Israelites were teaching that we'd be up out of here, but not every Israelite was teaching that. But they want to run with that narrative. So January 9th, 9 days after the end of the year, after 2019, after the year of return and all that stuff going on with Ghana. And then also they suspected that this thing was around prior to January, all the way possibly back in December. But people don't want to talk about that. January 9th. Let me get a sip of water. January 9th. At this point, the World Health Organization still has doubts about the roots of what will become, you know, that thing, noting that the state that a spate of pneumonia-like cases in Wuhan could have stemmed from a new that thing. There are 59 cases so far, and travel precautions are already at the forefront of experts' concerns. Y'all know we're not going back to the way it was before. The world has forever changed after 2019, right? But they don't say they don't see nothing with this. They don't think it has nothing to do with judgment. Oh, well, this always happens. Okay, cool. We're going to show a series of events that supposedly always happen. January 20th, three additional cases of what is now the 2019 novel, that thing, are reported in Thailand and Japan. Well, anyway, this gives a timeline. I'm not going to go through all this. Y'all can see this for yourself. Link will be in the description. You can see the timeline of the development of this thing. I'm just scrolling down so y'all can see how deep it is. Let me accept that cookie thing. I'm just scrolling down so y'all can see how extensive and detailed and long this is. Oh, but nothing happened at the end of 2019. The 400 years went by and everybody was wrong according to them. According to them, because they don't want to talk about what's going on in the earth right now. Yet some of them will open a big mouth and tell you we're living in the last days. But when judgment happens, it's wrong because Israel said it, and it's not really judgment, but they'll tell you that it happens in the last days. I thought judgment happened in the last days, according to all the Christian doctrine and teaching I've ever been exposed to, other than amillennialism. I don't believe amillennialism for one second. I personally believe amillennialism is a false teaching. Because it can't be right, and dispensationalism can't be right at the same time. One of them is wrong, and I believe amillennialism is wrong. But let's keep going. A running list of record-breaking natural disasters in 2020. Y'all can read this whole thing yourself. I'll just point out a few. Hurricanes. This is only the second time that the official alphabetical list of hurricane names has been used up, meaning forecasters have had to move to the supplementary list of Greek letter names. The 2020 season surpassed 2005 as the one with the most named storms on record, 30. Named storms are those which reach at least a tropical storm strength with winds of 39 to 73 miles per hour. 27 of the 30 storms that formed this season were the earliest of their storm number to do so. For example, Delta was the earliest 25th named storm of any season, beating out Tropical Storm Gamma, which formed on November 15, 2005. But anyway, you guys can go through this. Wildfires, rain and flooding, heat overall. Through September, the U.S. had 16 natural disasters, including wildfires, hurricane, tornadoes, and drought, that each caused at least $1 billion in damage, tying the record set in both 2011 and 2017, with several months left to go. Such statistics have been compiled since 1980. Y'all can go through and read this. This is clearly not an Israelite. Andrea Thompson is not pushing an Israelite agenda. This is why I'm using Scientific American. That first source was AJMC.com. What does it stand for? I just want to make sure. Let me see if I can find an about real quick. Let's go to the main page. I just want you guys to see what they're covering. AJMC. I know this is medical. I just want to see what it stands for. Let me see if I can find the about page. So anyway, this is a medical website. I don't see the about page. You guys can get over here and find this about page if you want to. But basically, the AJMC has to do with medical stuff. Not controlled by Israelites, not ran by Israelites, but let's keep going. Matrix, I don't know how many of you guys saw that. The Biblical Locust Plagues of 2020. This is from BBC.com. This is not an Israelite website. East Africa is seeing its worst swarms of locusts in many decades. How can these ravenous pests be stopped? So you guys can read this. I'll put the link in the description. We also have this from NPR. Locusts are a plague of biblical scope in 2020. Why? And what are they exactly? It's East Africa again. But they want to tell you nothing happened after 2019. Everything remained the same. Business as usual. Nothing weird going on. There's been tons of UFO sightings, which I'm not going to get into. But let's keep going. Earthquakes. Utah earthquake damages Mormon temple and knocks trumpet from iconic angel statue. So the angel Moroni dropped his trumpet. This trumpet right here. There was an earthquake that knocked the trumpet out of the angel's hand. When was this? March. Oh, let me go back down. It's going to move. March 18th, 2020. This by itself ain't a sign, but I think it's pretty funny that it happened that this angel dropped his trumpet in Utah. He actually dropped it on top of their Mormon temple and did some damage, not a ton of damage. Let's keep going. We're going to be wrapping this up soon. We got a couple more video things to show y'all, and then we're gonna wrap it up. Let's come up here. Murder hornets in the U.S., the rush to stop the Asian giant hornet. You guys can go through and read this yourself. This is updated September 13th, 2021, but it was originally published May 2nd, 2020. And it's about the murder hornets. But the murder hornets do this thing where they kill honeybees and cut off their heads and wipe out whole nests. First murder hornet nest found to have 200 queens capable of spawning new nests. So these murder hornets hit the U.S. They supposedly found one, and it had 200 queens in it that could spawn new nests. Right here, inside, researchers found this nest had 500 murder hornets, 190 total larvae that developed from eggs, 108 pupa. The next stage after the larva, they were nearly all queens. 112 workers, which included 85 workers previously vacuumed out of the nest, 76 queens, nearly all of them virgin queens. New queens emerge from the nest, mate, and then leave to find a place to spend winter and later start a new colony. So we don't even know how many escaped. And we mentioned that in the article as well. So now, let's talk about the loss of honeybees. These murder hornets kill honeybees, but let's see what it says. What happens if the honeybees are wiped out? In terms of agriculture, the loss of bees would dramatically alter human food systems, but would not likely lead to a famine. The majority of human calories still come from cereal grains, which are wind pollinated and are therefore unaffected by bee populations. Many fruits and vegetables, however, are insect pollinated and could not be grown at such a large scale or so cheaply without bees. Blueberries and cherries, for example, rely on honeybees for up to 90% of their pollination. Although hand pollination is a possibility for most fruit and vegetable crops, it is incredibly labor-intensive and expensive. Tiny robotic pollinator drones have been developed in Japan, but remain prohibitively expensive for entire orchards or fields of time-sensitive flowers. Without bees, the availability and diversity of fresh produce would decline substantially, and human nutrition would likely suffer. Crops that would not be cost effective to hand or robot pollinate would likely be lost or persist only with the dedication of human hobbyists. And same thing over here. It would mean a lot more than fewer stings and breakfast options. Maddie Moat reveals just how much we depend on bees and how close we are to losing them. All these will be in the description. So now let's look at something. So now after the judgment happens, there's an exodus. We'll go to 32 right here. Israel regathered from the land of their captivity. This is mentioned in Zephaniah 3:20, Jeremiah 29, chapter 30, chapter 33, chapter 46. It's also mentioned in Revelation 15 where the people sing the song of Moses, which is found in Exodus chapter 15, I believe. But we've looked at that already, so I'm not going to get too much into this. But Israel is regathered from the land of their captivity. And we'll just read, let's just pick one of these Jeremiah verses. Jeremiah 29:14. We'll read that, and you guys can grab the chart and read the rest of them on your own. Jeremiah 29, was it 14? Yep. And I will be found of you, saith the Lord, and I will turn away your captivity, and I will gather you from all the nations and from all the places whither I have driven you, saith the Lord, and I will bring you again into the place whence I caused you to be carried away captive. I'm going to bring you into the place where I caused you to be carried away captive. So now, there's this belief, some people believe, including myself, that there will be a wilderness stopover. And I'm going to show you guys where that's from. Go to Exodus chapter 5 real quick. We'll go to verses 1. Now, we're talking about the parallels. Remember, don't forget, we're talking about parallels between Egypt and the United States. It says, afterward, Moses and Aaron went in and told Pharaoh, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, let my people go that they may hold a feast unto me in the wilderness. So after they have been slaves, there's a judgment, and then there's an exodus. And then from the exodus, they end up in the wilderness. This is why we hear the story of them wandering around the wilderness. And then from the wilderness, they end up in the land. There is a pattern of events. There's an order of events. I'm saying that on purpose. So now let's look at Exodus 7:16. And thou shalt say unto him, the Lord God of the Hebrews hath sent me unto thee, saying, let my people go, that we may serve him in the wilderness. And behold, hitherto thou wouldest not hear. So again, they want to leave so they can go to the wilderness. So let's wrap this up with Ezekiel, not the whole study, this wilderness thing with Ezekiel chapter 20. This is why many people believe that after the Exodus, so there's a 400-year servitude, a judgment. I don't know how long the judgment lasts. I'm not putting years on it. In the Christian church, I was taught that it was a 7-year judgment broken into the tribulation and the great tribulation. 3.5 years of tribulation, 3.5 years of great tribulation. That's what I was taught when I was more active in the Christian church. So I don't know how long the judgment is going to be, if it's exactly 7 years, more or less. But I know there's a judgment after the 400 years because the Bible says so. We read it in the Bible. It says so. So Ezekiel chapter 20, we go down to verse 35. And I will bring you into the wilderness of the people, and there I will plead with you face to face. Hold on, let me go back to verse. Let me right here. God will restore Israel to her land. Now, let me read it in order. So in the Exodus, servitude, judgment, Exodus, wilderness, then the land. Same thing I teach about what's happening here. As I live, saith the Lord God, surely with a mighty hand, with a stretched out arm, and with fury poured out will I rule over you. And I will bring you out from the people, and will gather you out of the countries wherein you were scattered, with a mighty hand, and with a stretched out arm, and with fury poured out. If that ain't the book of Revelation, then I don't know what's going on in Revelation. And I will bring you into the wilderness of the people, and there will I plead with you face to face, like as I pleaded with your fathers in the wilderness. So after he gathers them out of the countries where they were scattered, he's going to bring them into the wilderness of the people. If anybody tells you this has been fulfilled, ask them when and where, and tell them to show you the receipts. Like as I pleaded with your fathers in the wilderness of the land of Egypt, so will I plead with you, saith the Lord God. And I will cause you to pass under the rod, and I will bring you into the bond of the covenant, and I will purge out from among you the rebels and them that transgress against me. I will bring them forth out of the country where they sojourn, and they shall not enter into the land of Israel, and you shall know that I am the Lord. What happened to Moses? Moses didn't enter the land because Moses was disobedient. And so in that regard, Moses becomes an example for this prophecy laid out in Ezekiel. When we get to prophecies like this, they want to act like the prophets ain't no longer prophets. They want to say, oh, well, how does this apply to their time? Well, this didn't happen in their time. So he's going to bring them out, the people that are scattered into all the countries, and he's going to bring them to the wilderness. He's going to plead with them there. Then he's going to get rid of the rebels right here. I will purge out from among you the rebels and them that transgress against me. I will bring them forth out of the country where they sojourn, and they shall not enter into the land of Israel. Meaning somebody is going to enter into the land of Israel, and that yet they want to tell you it's not about the land of Israel. Those promises are no longer valid. They're all null and void. So now we see that. So let's go down to right here. They shall not enter into the land of Israel. And let's go to number 45 on the chart. We see that there's promises, the land, heritage restored to Israel. We see that in the book of Deuteronomy. We see this in the book of Psalms, Isaiah, Ezekiel. Let's keep going. Where else? Jeremiah and the book of Revelation. Let's go to Ezekiel 36, 33-35. We'll just pick one random. You guys can get the chart again for free and download it and, you know, read it yourself and do all the cross-referencing. And they shall say, this land that was desolate has become like the Garden of Eden, and the waste and desolate and ruined cities have become fenced, and they are inhabited. So the land is going to be inhabited. The ruined cities are going to be fenced. But yeah, you guys go through all these, go through all of these yourself. Don't take my word for it. Check all of these references. It's why I wrote them here, not to prove that Israel's black, but to show where all these instances of prophetic things are mentioned in scripture. And so if they're going to say that this one's been fulfilled, then they need to explain this one and the, each of these and these and these and all of these. Make them explain everything and show you the receipts and how it all lines up. So now we're gonna get into some interesting medicine. So now Berean made a comment. So they previously, before the video clips I showed you of Berean and Jada producer talking and taking things out of context, they played a clip of me reading number 46, Israel must repent to be delivered from slavery. And I read some of these verses. And then number 49, Israel has the power to contact the Most High. I read this. Now, what you're about to hear from Berean are his comments. Now, after he don't let them speak, he's going to come back and lie on me. He's going to come back and lie on me. I'm going to say it one more time. He's going to come back and lie on me. And I'm going to point something out. Because now Berean is about to get two doses of medicine from them big white bottles after I let him tell his lie. But I want y'all to hear this. Let me see where I need to stop it at. I know where to stop it. I just want y'all to hear Berean lie on me. I'm gonna point the lie out.
It's not speaking to 400 years of slavery. It's just,
but this is my 400 years being here. But y'all do see, I want to know if all you Christians in here see why they got to lift up Israel. They got to lift up and preach. You got to keep the law, statutes, and commandments. Dante said that we could call Israel, not me and these ignorant Africans, but Israel can call back Messiah.
Now you heard him. He said, Dante said. Now right here, he's going to be telling the truth, and he's about to lie.
They can hasten his coming. I don't want to take nobody's words out of. They can.
See, it has nothing to do with hastening his coming. I'm about to show y'all why I'm about to do the big bottle of medicine. Hold on. Before I get to that big bottle of medicine, there's another bottle of medicine I want to pour out first. Let me touch on something before we get to that, because I think this is pertinent. When we're talking about the order of events, before we get to Berean, I know y'all want to see that. Before we get to Berean, y'all hit that thumbs up. Hit that thumbs up, please. If you're enjoying this, press one in the chat. Make sure y'all subscribe. We're going to come over here to the 11-minute mark. 11-minute. I will put it right there. So I want to point out something. Why I'm pointing out these order of events that I did. The 400 years, the harsh bondage, the killing of the males, the judgment, the exodus, the wilderness, and then back to the land. The order of events. Listen to this.
But understand how it works. Okay, keep going on the Egypt thing, because this is interesting.
As you said, I mean, it kind of developed from there. Everything you see in that pattern in the book of Exodus, you see it taking shape, which would then bring us to this point. The next thing that happens after the tax masters, after the hard labor
and aborting the babies,
making them serve with rigor, and the abortion of the babies, etc., what's eventually going to happen? We're going to have plagues are going to be poured out. Why?
Ooh, we're going to have plagues. Let me just let it play.
Wow.
Because.
Oh, wow. So true.
Because, number one, all those things happen. You know, we need to keep in mind God allowed that king to come to power. He allowed it because God raises up, he brings down. So he allowed that to happen. Why did he allow it to happen? Here's one reason. Because his people, Israel, had become so assimilated into Egyptian culture They had become so mixed with what the Egyptians thought was important to serving their gods that if he had allowed them to continue that way, eventually his people would have assimilated into Egypt and Israel would have disappeared.
They would have.
Now, y'all listen to people. He talk about Israel assimilating into Egyptian culture. Now, if y'all listen to some of these people talk, oh, Christmas is just American culture. They're assimilating. Easter is just American culture. They are assimilating into this other culture. And he's pointing out that God had to intervene before these people assimilated fully into the American culture or to the Egyptian culture. But we see that here in the black church, they are fully assimilating into American culture. They will defend stuff that ain't in the Bible. They defend that Christmas tree so hard that ain't even biblical. They always talk about biblical and preaching Christ. Put down the Christmas tree and preach Christ. Stop putting the Christmas tree over Christ. Stop putting the Easter bunny, the eggs, the magic elves, the flying reindeer, the mistletoe, the wreath, all that stuff. Stop putting it over Christ and preach Christ. Don't preach to me no Christmas tree, no Christmas, no Easter. Don't preach none of that to me. Don't try to justify it or nothing if it ain't in the book. Don't make Christmas your doctrine. Don't make Easter your doctrine. You know, the kind of stuff they say to us.
Never come out of their bondage.
They would have never come. Absolutely. They would have never come out, never fulfilled God's purpose for them.
Mm-hmm.
He can't allow that to happen. So let's compare that to today. You know, you said something that I believe it was in the previous program, words to this effect. The troubling thing about what is going on today is not so much about what the world is doing as much as it is what God's people are allowing to come in, how God's people are caving to some of these things and what God's people are doing. And so that's kind of what was going on in Egypt in a way of speaking. So he allows that king to arise to do what? In a sense, remind them who they are.
Oh, wait. To what? To remind them who they are? But wait, I thought y'all said we had to preach the awakening. Israelites had to preach the awakening. Dante got to preach the awakening. Look like this white guy right here is preaching an awakening, talking about God had to remind them who they are.
Remind them who they are to serve and to, in a spiritual way, set themselves apart. And here's what happened when the plagues...
Are they supposed to be set apart? That means not doing the things that the other nations are doing? Come on now. I just want y'all to really, really... listen to this big old dose of medicine from the white bottle.
Started to be poured out. After the first three plagues, you will see that God sets a division between his people and between the Egyptians.
Mm.
Why? So that in the end, they shall know that I am the Lord. Not only Pharaoh and the Egyptians, but his people as well. So he sets a distinction between his people and the Egyptians. He sets a distinction between his people and the world because that's what we're called to be. So all that was to say, behind the king coming to power, the purpose of it is not so much a reflection on the wickedness of the world,
mm-hmm.
but it's actually to accentuate that my people
need
to humble themselves, seek my face and pray, turn from their wicked ways. So that's what I believe is happening right now. Let me throw this.
Oh, he believes that's happening right now. And again, he's not talking about us. However, everything is right under his nose that he's saying. But he ain't talking about us. Now, in 2014, when I was still involved with some of these white pastors and I was still doing this research and coming to the conclusion, I told them that one of the biggest fulfillment of Bible prophecy is happening right in front of their face. And they're going to miss it because they don't want to acknowledge that the people it's happening to are the same people they oppressed and enslaved for 400 years in this country.
In there too, Perry, real quick. Because we are called to be a set apart, a holy people, that's what holy means. We are to be separate from the nations in the sense we're not to do what the nations do, not to live the way the nations live.
Oh, wait, they're saying, this is a European saying, we're not to do what the nations do, Christmas, Easter. We're not to live the way the nations live, celebrating American customs and cultures and all that other stuff. We're not supposed to do that according to him. But when Israelites come and say it, we're Judaizing. But if he says it, he's just being legalistic. Now, notice how the terms will change, how they use these terms. I'm teaching y'all how to identify the way these devils move. And I'm not talking about these guys on the screen. I'm talking about some of these other people who call themselves Christians, these black ones out here that treat Israel like trash.
If we won't voluntarily answer that call,
mm-hmm.
you know what God does? He uses the nations to bring us to a place.
So true. Yeah.
That if we won't separate ourselves, he'll use the nations to separate us, but against our will. And that's what Pharaoh did. He put them in this situation where they were being oppressed, but what did that provoke in God's people. They begin to cry out
to God. Yeah.
That's what I believe is going on right now, Perry.
All right, so that's what he believes is going on right now. Hey, he don't believe it's us. They're overlooking us, but they believe it's them. You heard how he referred to himself as one of those people. Now, let's get back to Berean. Now, I want y'all to hear what Berean had to say about me. Let me rewind it just a little. Fair use. I'm going to let y'all hear this.
From 1619, when the slaves were... They tell you in the document how they got 400 years. From the time that they put the document in place, dating back to 1619, they did this thing commemorating 400 years that Africans been in this country. Like, just in general. It's not speaking to 400 years of slavery. It's just
but y'all do see, I want to know if all you Christians in here see why they got to lift up Israel, they got to lift up and preach, you got to keep the law, statutes, and commandments. Dante said that we could call Israel, not me and these ignorant Africans, but Israel can call back Messiah, that they can, I guess they can hasten his coming.
No, Berean. One more time. It's not to hasten his coming. But you're about to get the medicine in two white bottles, two big old doses of it. Berean, what he's doing right now is he's misconstruing my words and he's taking it out of context. See, there's a reason he didn't want me up on this show. He tried to do like he did brother Zadok, or Zadok, as some of y'all call him. He told me it was pronounced Zadok when I first asked him. But I say Zadok because it's so much easier to remember when you see that Y there. Shout out to brother Zadok, brother Zadok, Young Chimney. But he wanted to do the same thing. So what he does is he'll talk about you and gossip behind your back. He don't want to tell you first. He want to do the show, and then he don't want to have the person on there to defend themselves, because that's how they move. That's how the church moves. He said that before. The church moves that way. And you have to wonder, is that how God would move, or is that how a devil would move?
I want to take nobody's words out of. They can hasten his coming if they go back to the law, statutes, and commandments.
Now, he started out saying Dante said they can call him back, and now he's saying they can hasten his coming if they go back to the law, statutes, and commandments. Y'all know for a fact I ain't ever taught that, ever. But he started off saying Dante said, and he strings this whole sentence together. Dante said, that's a lie, and you know it, Berean. I didn't never say that, so you need to clear that up. But, hey, if you don't clear it up, we already know what it is.
And that got to do with eating pork. That got to do with everything. If you start keeping them feast days,
I don't teach that.
Stop eating that pork and
I don't care what y'all eat. I'm not the plate patrol. I'm not looking at y'all plate. Y'all take that up with the Most High. Don't ask me nothing about no pork. Don't ask me nothing about no blood sausage. Don't ask me nothing about nothing. I'm not patrolling y'all plates. I'm not telling you to do it or not to do it. I'm telling y'all take that up with the Most High. And whatever you feel led to do, that's what you do.
Don't do the stuff that brought you into captivity, being hard-headed.
I want to point out something. Shout out to Jordan. Please, somebody read the bill, which is why I read it. They didn't want to read that bill. They want to just keep talking at it or around it or about it, but not actually address what's in it.
The thing that's going to turn around your captivity is starting to keep his law, statutes, and commandments, so they got to preach this. They got to. Lifting up Jesus is one thing, but they got to keep the commandments.
And that's why they ain't left yet. Because they still being hard-headed, because the thing that they're telling people they got to go do is not what God told you to do.
All right. You heard what Berean said. He laid that down, and then Jada producer said, that's why they ain't left yet, because the thing that God, well, the thing that they telling people to do, they not supposed to do. So now, here come the two doses. I know some of y'all don't like that medicine, but I'm about to cue it up. All right, here go the first dose for Berean. I want y'all to listen real closely to what these men are about to say. Because he said Dante said all this stuff. Now, I didn't say any of that stuff, but he said Dante said, and he gave you a whole string of sentences that Dante did not say. But let me go ahead and show you something that did get said by these Europeans.
You mentioned about how the pattern was after taxation, after the new king arose, the abortion, all that. Plagues started. How do you think Ebola, even though it's not...
Oh, wait, they're talking about plagues? There's a reason I read about that thing that hit the earth in 2020 that had us all on lockdown. Because see, now they're about to start talking about plagues. At that time, it was Ebola when Obama was in office. But we're looking at something right now. So they're putting together the same patterns we are. And they're using the Old Testament. I showed y'all this bottle before, but Berean about to get a dose right here, a big old healthy dose of this medicine from this white bottle.
You know, been rampant the way people were afraid it was going to be. The fact that it just got to our shores, does that say anything?
It does to me. I mean, we've known about Ebola at least since 1976. Mm-hmm. People have been going to Africa from America all those years to help these people, and rightfully so. And as far as I can tell, there has never been one case of the Ebola virus in the United States in the last 40 years until 2014.
And see, that they're trying to tie it to something else, as I said before. They don't believe we're the people, but we're seeing the exact same pattern that they're laying out. Israelites been talking about, but Alton Johnson, the deceiver, and Berean lets Alton Johnson have a voice on his platform. Alton Johnson is a moderator on his platform. This deceiver is saying this is One West doctrine, and yet we hear the Europeans teaching it right here. This is how we know that they are liars, deceivers, and devils. And I'm not talking about the Europeans because they want to say that we're talking, you know, we're racist against white people and white people are devils. No, I'm talking about you black devils over there. You lying black devils. Ain't that Berean called us? You lying black devils over there on Berean TV.
Why? Something else that comes to mind, and some people say, well, I don't see the connection. Well, I'm sorry, in my mind I do. Just in this last year in 2014, we had a man that jumped over the fence of the White House. All right, people do that all the time. But as soon
but
as they
they're
do,
usually caught exactly, within about 10 feet, the dog goes after
that's
them.
Exactly
because
right.
I have some friends that were in the Secret Service.
Right.
So it's yeah.
They do that. Secret Service is on them.
On it immediately.
Okay, but there was a little situation where a man was not only able to get across the lawn, he went to the front door, opened the door, went in, and ran around the first floor. Now, that's unheard of.
And was not the president nearby?
Well, now, I don't know.
A security guy jumped him and stopped him. But
now, after he was around the first floor.
And I was stunned.
Right.
It's like, you know what I mean? I was stunned by that.
Well, okay, so what should we read into that? All right. It's not water being turned to blood. It's not frogs in your bed. But
like a hedge is down.
Exactly. It's like God is saying the hedge is coming down. And if the hedge comes down, that means there are other things that are going to be coming. And all of this is found in the patterns of Scripture. And if you don't look at the Old Testament as anything other than a history, you're never going to see it. Mm-mm. But it is a living.
If you don't look at the Old Testament as anything other than history, you're never going to see it.
Breathing word, it's prophetic, and it speaks to us today. And so, just to kind of sum
he says
this
prophetic, living, breathing, and speaks to us today.
The patterns that we see in Egypt, and these others that we see as well, that we've talked about, but the patterns that we see in Egypt, to me, they speak as closely as anything does to where America is right now, and more specifically, where God's people in America are.
God's people in America, what? Again, he's overlooking the obvious group, but he believed, I'm telling y'all just keep listening. He's teaching that leaky camp doctrine. I know what this is. These Europeans got a hold of some of that camp doctrine, and now these European Christians are out here teaching leaky camp doctrine.
And what God is taking us to.
Okay, let me ask you this, in about 4 minutes left. I know what the answer is, but what is the answer for God's people? What do we have to do? Voting is a part of it. You know, we always try to vote the right people, but who's the right person? I mean, you know, people lie. They lie all the time to get in.
Well,
but let's go beyond just the voting part of everybody being active, voting who you feel is the right person. What can we do in the spiritual side that changes everything else around us?
Well, the first thing, Perry, I think we need to do is just put it out of our minds that going to the ballot box and voting for a Republican or a Democrat or an independent is going to change everything. It's not. Because we're in a situation, because it's a spiritual problem, it has to be dealt with in a spiritual way. Right?
I agree. Absolutely.
So this guy getting elected or that guy being voted out of office is not going to change it. If Hollywood shut down today, even though I think that would be a step in the right direction, talking about donkeys talking to people, it's not going to change the fundamental problem.
Right, because it's a spiritual problem.
Because we have abandoned the covenant.
Yes.
We have turned our face away from God. And so the only remedy to
What did he say? Abandon the covenant? Turn their face away from God? He's starting to sound like an Israelite. He's starting to sound like one of them campers out there. Let me keep going. He preaching leaky camp doctrine.
is when God's people, not necessarily those people out in the world, but when God's people, because it doesn't say if those people who don't know who I am, or those people who would deny
right
that I
me.
Even
yeah.
exist.
Get right with me. Yeah.
It doesn't say that. It says, if my people. And so if God turns his face away, as he said, and we bring this out in the book, the only remedy is to turn our face back toward him. Not to change, not to go forward, but to return to him. And so when we turn our face back to him, the Bible tells us very plainly, he turns his face back to us.
Mm. Oh, wait, you got to turn back to God. You got to turn back to the Most High. That thing that Brian said, we got to preach the awakening. Y'all go through and listen to this yourself. We got to turn back to him. This is what he's saying. They said this. So now let me go ahead and get the second bottle out. I'm going to give y'all another one of these European preachers that sound like Leaky Camp Doctrine teachers to me. I'm about to let y'all hear this, and then we're going to wrap this up. Y'all hit the thumbs up button. Make sure you share this. Make sure you subscribe. Again, patreon.com/Dante Fortson if you want to support. Hashtag BHITB in the Cash App anytime. Let me get this other bottle out. Here we go. Chuck Missler, Israel in the Church, My People Israel. Let's listen to Chuck's Leaky Camp Doctrine that he's about to preach right here, and we're going to go ahead and wrap this up, and then part three, we're going to get back into the history. Here we go. Thumbs up this video if you have not done so already.
I always used to wonder, let me back up. Jesus, God says in Hosea 5:15, I will go and return to my place. That must mean he left it. You can't return to your place unless you've left your place, right? I will go and return to my place until, there's another one of those, until they...
I want y'all to notice the date on here. It's going to... when it drops back down, this is from 2012. Now, the one I just showed you with Perry Stone was from 2015. Chuck Missler was teaching his Leaky Camp Doctrine back in 2012, but let's go.
They acknowledge their offense and seek my face. In their affliction, they will seek me earnestly. Until they acknowledge their offense, that's singular and specific, it's the rejection of their Messiah. And seek my face. In their affliction, they will seek me earnestly. So that obviously is going to take place in what Daniel 12 calls the Great Tribulation. And Jesus even quotes that, and we'll see that here in a minute.
Now, the Great Tribulation, real quick, is that last half of the 7 years, that 3.5 year period that many of us learned in church was the Great Tribulation.
To always wonder, why is Satan so busy? I can understand him doing that up until the cross. But as I understand the cross, that was it. It was nailed. I'm not trying to make a crude pun there. That should have ended. You would think that determined the outcome, wouldn't you? Why then is he so busy, especially harassing Israel and specifically the believers in Israel?
Oh, why is he busy harassing Israel and specifically the believers in Israel? I don't know. Let's ask one of them devils. Why is the devil busy harassing Israel and the believers in Israel? Any of you devils on Berean's channel, free to answer that question. Any of you devils over there?
Why? And this verse clarified it to me, because there is no prerequisite condition for the harpazo.
The harpazo is the Greek word for snatching away, or the word they refer to as the rapture. He said there's no precondition for the rapture, but listen to what he's about to say.
But there is a prerequisite condition for the second coming of Christ. And that is for Israel to petition him.
The prerequisite condition is for Israel to petition Christ? Didn't you hear Berean say that Dante said Israel can call him back to hasten the coming? No, I wasn't talking about hastening the coming. In fact, I was introduced to this idea by Chuck Missler, which is where I got it from. So when Berean says we have to teach the awakening, we have to push the awakening, Berean didn't even realize that I'm teaching something that I learned from a European Christian prior to 2012. But anyway, we're gonna keep going, because this is put out in 2012, but I had already heard this prior to 2012, and I had already looked into this, and this is why I had the scriptures. But Berean didn't want to give you that part. He would rather paint a false narrative and lie and start talking about me pushing the law and eating pork and all that nonsense.
And that's what Hosea 6 is all about. Here he says, I will go and return to my place until they acknowledge their offense and seek my face. In their affliction, they will seek me earnestly. That's a prerequisite. He has to be invited. And it's my suspicion, I don't want to teach this, it's my suspicion that that's Satan's strategy. If he can wipe out the believing remnant, that he can thwart the plan of God. That's why he's so intense in that direction.
Oh, wow, look. Israel has to invite back the Messiah according to a European Christian. And the other European Christian said Israel has to turn back, his people have to turn back. We're going to leave it right there. I hope Brian enjoyed them two big old bottles of European medicine I got for him. So next time, Brian, don't take me out of context. Don't add words to what I'm saying. If you don't know where I got it from, don't say we have to teach the awakening, because I wasn't teaching the awakening in 2012 at all. I hadn't even begun to study this subject about black people being Israel in 2012. Everybody knows my story. I didn't really start to teach this. I started digging into it in 2014. It wasn't until 2015 that I started to really, really acknowledge everything and put up Black History in the Bible and started to teach everything, not everything that I'm teaching now, but started to teach on this subject. And it wasn't because we have to teach the awakening. This is what was passed down into the Christian circles that I was around back then in these years, 2012, 2013, 2014, early part of 2015, all the way since 2009, really. But Berean didn't know what he was talking about, so he wanted to throw my name in something. This is why I had a big bottle of European medicine prepared. I wasn't even going to say nothing to Berean or about Berean, but Berean brought up my name, as y'all heard. So anyway, y'all hit this thumbs up button. Make sure y'all tag Berean in it. Make sure y'all hit the subscribe button, and make sure y'all share these videos. We got another one coming. We got a part three coming to this, the United States of Egypt. So make sure y'all are ready for it by clicking the notification bell. Turn on all notification. Turn on all YouTube notifications. So thank y'all for listening. With that said, till next time, I'm out.